and welcome. It's a great pleasure to introduce this evening Sir Peter Cook. There's probably no living architect today who needs less of an introduction, of course, than Peter Cook. He's a legend, a mythical figure who has been shaking up the discourse, practice, and imagination of architecture and its possibilities since the 60s, when he founded, together with Warren Chalk, Ron Heron, Dennis Crompton, and Michael Webb, and David Green, the radically experimental group Archigram. I still remember vividly my first encounter with Cook and Archigram's work. It was on the occasion of their retrospective exhibition at the Centre Georges Pompidou, sometime maybe in the mid-80s, I would guess. This is still one of the most mind-blowing exhibitions I've seen. The sheer excess of imagination, the reinvention of everyday life, the embrace of technological innovation for pure play and unbridled pleasure, a radical faith in the future, in progress, and in thinking architecture as environment, as media, infrastructure, as mobile, lightweight, plugged in capsule form, instantly consumable, disposable, and more importantly, unapologetically sexy. The freshness and irreverence of endlessly projected new worlds, with names such as Walking City, Instant City, Plug-in City, Living Pod, etc., was not only highly influential for the speculative ideas they presented, they were ultimately seminal for architecture as radical new forms of representation. Beyond the environments were the drawings themselves, which embodied architecture at its most fundamental level. Architects don't build as much as they draw, as our own Reinhold Martin often says, and drawing is what Archigram contributed in sheer, endlessly inspiring excess. In his recently republished Drawing the Motive Force of Architecture, Cook writes, "Much of the most memorable or most definitive architecture comes forth at a moment when a set of ideas exists as a form of attack, a retort to another set of ideas. The pressure of rhetoric or drive needing to find an outlet, needing to shout loudly to insist, awaken, reveal. A paradoxy of drawn mannerisms or deliberately chosen cool in response to hot or sparse in response to complex, closely paralleling the architecture itself or its cultural background. At this point, we must face a nagging suspicion," he continues, "that the drawing can possibly be better than the reality." Reflecting on the relationship of drawing to computer renderings, Cook also notes in his video The Battle of Drawing from the retrospective of drawings at the Chobin Foundation in Berlin recently. The other thing is that the computer does things correctly. I think in architecture it is important to do things incorrectly. Drawing is more than a tool, it is the extension of one's head. It is its waywardness as well as its accuracy of depiction that is important. This passion for drawing's power certainly contributed to rendering Cook's time as the director of the ICA in London and then of the Bartlett School of Architecture both legible and highly memorable, a legacy which continues until today and is testimony to Cook's seminal and often sizzling contribution as a great educator. But, as I noted maybe earlier, great architects continue to reinvent themselves, and in recent years, Peter Cook has given us wonderful buildings. In 2016, he completed the drawing studio at the Arts University in Bournemouth, where his passion for drawing inspired a beautifully lit and sensuous studio space. In 2014, the playful, theatrical, and filled with unexpected moments for meeting and interaction, Abedian School of Architecture was completed at Bond University in Australia, receiving the National MBA Public Building Award, the AIA Gold Coast Building of the Year, and the Education and Health Inside Award, WAF. The snaking and colorful Vienna University School of Economics was completed in 2014 and received the RIBA European Award, as well as the WAF Color Award. And maybe the most Archigram-like, the alien-like, Kunsthaus Graz of 2003 received a RIBA European Award. Peter's achievements have been, of course, widely recognized, too many to name here all tonight, but of note is In 2004, Archigram's members were awarded the RIBA's highest award, the Royal Gold Medal. In 2007, Peter was knighted by the Queen for his services to architecture, and he is a Royal Academician and a Commandeur de l'Ordre des Arts et Lettres of the French Republic, and is currently a Senior Fellow of the Royal College of Art in London. His professorships include those of the Royal Academy, University College London, and the, I cannot say this, Steidulch in Frankfurt, Main, Germany. Peter's continuing work as a lecturer of considerable renown makes him a familiar voice within cultural institutions around the world, and so we are really incredibly honored and thrilled to have him tonight with us, and we're also excited that Bernard, our own Bernard Tumi, will offer his response. So please join me in welcoming Peter Cook.
It's interesting in your introduction that you talked about these businesses of teaching and exhibiting and making books and making drawings, the things that are really support services to the fundamental business, which is the making of architecture. This rather curious path towards, and this rather curious mixture now as it stands of a lot of drawing and a bit of building and a lot of talking and a lot of events like this, which one really uses to rethink constantly what it all adds up to. And I just come in 5 days ago from opening probably my largest solo exhibition, which is to celebrate the new, rather horrible, building of the Bartlett, the rebuilt Bartlett. But we sort of screwed it up with a lot of funny drawings. And it is, I think it's a good place to start. The other thing is, of course, an explanation for my... Oh, that's funny. It should have another slide on. Yeah. Ah, well, there was an explanation of my title, Dreams and Reality. Many years ago, when he was more often in the street that we live in, up the top of the street, I bumped into Rem Koolhaas, and we reminisced about the days at the A when we were all considered to be artists. Artists, we weren't anywhere near the business of building. And then we listed out all the people who, in between, had actually started to build. And the list was long. It included all these so-called artists or wankers or theorists or whatever you might call them. And we listed out the number of buildings that we'd done between us. And then we said, what do they say now? Because in a way, it was a conspiracy theory. It was extremely convenient for the people out there to put us in a useful pigeonhole, which is that we are non-competent. We are involved in these support activities and these visionary activities, so-called. Okay, this is a sort of potpourri of what happened 5 nights ago. And it of course, is another attempt to post-rationalize. And I gave up post-rationalizing halfway through planning the exhibition. It is a conglomeration, not quite as chaotic as it looks in the collage there, but it is a conglomeration of things dreamt of and things built. And the question this evening is to what extent the dreams have sometimes touched with reality and to what extent the dreams continue to be dreams and to what extent it might be useful for them to be. And maybe you have to come to the conclusion of what is useful. I go back autobiographically to the formative period of my architectural experience, which is, I am not actually from this town, but I'm supposed to be from it, because it saves people a lot of bother in listing out the 10 other towns in which I lived as an army brat. But Bournemouth is a funny place in which to go to architecture school. It was the smallest school in England at the time. It was the last place in England that you had to learn the 5 orders of architecture and to be able to draw them using scale rather than using dividers and so on. And it is a town which is a sort of retirement seaside town and a repository for a very large number of Victorian churches. And I wonder about that, because although we were having James Gibb drummed down our throat, I wonder if it wasn't the churches that I was sort of subconsciously interested in. I remain If the 19th century classification is to be made, I remain a Gothicist rather than a classicist. But there are other seaside memories I had as this army brat. One little town in particular called Felixstowe, who none of you will know, had a conglomeration of three bits of building that stayed in my brain for years and years and years. It's a little lunar park. The Helter Skelter, I realized afterwards, after all, was the first time I'd seen a megastructure. The cafe on the right, I realized afterwards, was the first time that I'd seen Art Deco. And the little tiny funny house at the bottom led me in a long roundabout way towards a taste for Pilsy. But then I came to London. I was to the AA, on state money, incidentally. What was interesting was that I had been reading and had read everything I could lay hands on about the Smithsons and Paolozzi and Sterling, the then Sterling and Gowan and so on. But I went to hear a lecture on my second day in the AA given by that same Paolozzi, and only six people turned up. But the same night, 250 people turned up to hear about English arts and crafts. And I was shocked as a modernist provincial, as a futurist provincial, whatever it was. And I wonder about that. That sometimes the raw, unwashed, tacky provincial is hungry for what's really important going on at the time. Okay, this was followed, of course, by the heroic Archigram period, which we celebrate, we continue to celebrate, and I think even Dennis Crompton is in the room, who has made a wonderful industry of keeping the flame alive of Archigram. It was heroic stuff. I look at it and wonder how we had the balls to do it at the time. I look at it and I think, what was really going on in my mind? I keep telling PhD students and those people who try to reinvent history that actually the plug-in city was not so much about technology for me, it was about romanticism. It was romanticizing the idea of the prefabricated object. And then I entered school. A very funny thing happened, which was that I was brought in after being on many, many, many crits at the AA to be a humble but useful person called the assistant to the fifth year master. Now, traditionally, the assistant to the fifth year master is sort of factotum who runs the grand master and is a useful person to see if you're feeling sick or your girlfriend's left you or whatever the hell. In fact, I had published Plug-in City in of no other thing than the Sunday Times colour supplement, which at that time was read by more than a million people. Every one of those students sitting there thought, what am I going to do with this guy? I had never had the comfort of anonymity. And I think that has obviously coloured one's attitude towards teaching. One has been a person of rhetoric without even asking to be. And this drawing, in comparison with the previous one, was done a year later. I did almost no drawing in my first year of teaching. I became an amateur psychologist, I think, rather than anything else, and hardly drew at all. And then in the summer, it all came out, and the relative additional layering of ideas into the maximum intensity area compared with the early drawing was interesting, because I don't think I've ever followed that again, that one hardly drew for a year, but somehow it was all running around in one's head, and one was probably already starting to do that thing that I've done ever since, which is to have sort of subconscious conversations with one's students when you're doing a drawing, or subconscious conversations with friends when you're doing a drawing. If you'll enjoy this, what about that? I think you'd go. You'll hate this. And it led to various other more formalized aspects of the Plug-in City. In a way, I think, looking back on it, the Plug-in University was actually a piece of neoclassicism, which is not really what Plug-in City was about, which is a piece of romanticism. And then this led to the Instant City, which of course was the period. Interestingly, a drawing done on my first trip to the United States, I was on the faculty at UCLA, and I sat drawing an imagined situation in England, but I was sitting in LA. And I wonder to what extent the drawing itself was affected by that subconscious looking over the shoulder at the sort of googly architecture could have done. And then, at a certain point, one reapplied it back to sort of hometown. The first dream I want to cogitate upon is what I call the dream of physical metamorphosis. And I look not only at the early metamorphic project, but I look at the exhibition 5 days ago, where the metamorphing projects are still in there as keys to some of the more static projects. And the morphing still goes on, certainly in some competition projects. So they tend to be the ones that we don't win. The more static ones seem to have a better chance. And a key project, really, is the one of 67, which was the urban mark, the notion of something that had a sort of generic follow-on from the plug-in city, going stage by stage into a condition of what the late Cedric Price would have called a scrambled egg. And later, with a favorite project of my wife's, which is the Way Out West Berlin, which was discussing the fact that at that time, West Berlin was still walled from the east and was propped up by American money. But I chose a site which was at the western end of the great West Berlin street, the Kurfürstendamm. And I was fascinated because I'm greatly a lover of that street. But it's weird because about a mile and a half up it just sort of peters out. There's nothing at the end. I was fascinated by the territory. What would happen if there was something at the end? What would happen if that was America? What would happen if it was west, the west of the west? Ah, but the wild west. And I used the cactus of all architectural icons as a kind of focus for the metamorphosis of the bits and pieces. And here we can see three out of the five stages of metamorphosis of the actual ground plan itself. Years later, when getting involved in vegetation, which I will come back to, interestingly, or sadly, or ironically, many of my projects have involved vegetation. We've never, though we have started to do building, none of our actual clients ever seems to want any, even if we sometimes draw the vegetation usefully kind of ameliorating the hard surfaces. They say, yes, that might be very nice, but we don't want it to happen. So there is this interesting sort of resistance. But in this project, which I only show three out of the six stages, one starts off with a small triangulated sheltered area for the dwelling and some armatures that have reasonable little bits of vegetation on them and some beginnings of hybrid equipment, which is between audiovisual, growies, things to do with ventilation and so on. And over time, it sprouts. The vegetation creeps in and the apparatus becomes kind of combinations of different kinds of apparatus. And then the series of drawing goes on. And this is something that has often happened with drawing where I have in my head the general program of the project and how it will change. But only about two stages ahead. And when I get to stage two, I'm already thinking about what stage three or four will do. And then somehow the scheme takes over. It's very weird. There's a certain point at which you're drawing something you never couldn't even imagine you might be drawing. And it usually gets into an absurd state towards the end where you say, my God, I've hatched a monster. And then you bail, or you stop. You elegantly say this was, of course, the intention that there would only be six stages of this thing. But of late, of course, there's another kind of physical metamorphosis that occurs, which is of the built object itself. So this is the Australian, the scoop, one of the scoops of the Australian building, photographed in the early stages when simply almost the raw figure is there. When the raw figure starts to involve in other raw figures, and then at the smooth, at the shaved version, at the cosmeticized stage of the thing, and the thing is in a constant state of metamorphosis. Or to take another building, the Vienna building, on the left, the day it was opened, and on the right, a photograph taken only 1 year later, mostly containing things that we intended to happen. Certainly the vegetation, certainly the graying of the slats, certainly the patina occurring on the concrete. Other things may happen when bits start dropping off that we won't have wanted to happen. But in general, one enjoys, and this may be being an old sort of hairy European, one enjoys the notion of patina. There's, of course, in parallel, the metamorphosis of an idea. One is familiar with this from the process, let's say, of sketching, of moving towards something, and then on the right, a stage at which the process has reached some kind of nearly conclusion. Or there is another one, a rather interesting sequence a few years ago, where I was asked to do a drawing for AD magazine. I can't remember what the issue was, but I was interested in talking about something I've always wanted to happen, to go to, which was a comfortable vegetated club. You don't see the liquor and the sound, but you get the general idea of a comfo veg club. Fairly normal intention, I think. And then Eric Moss down in SIARC said, why don't you come and do an exhibition? And I did an installation with my friends, which was to some extent the Comfo Veg Club. It was only an $8,000 operation, so it couldn't have a lot of the gadgetry. But it did a bit of it. And indeed, it was comfortable and vegetated. In fact, I can report that it was so comfortable that very naughty things happened late at night, which I regard as a success. And then, in fact, I've done something there which I haven't been able to do very often, which is to report back to the original drawing. So I copied the installed part and then had further thoughts about what it could be. So you kind of roll over a meager project in the middle, and then you move forward. I'd like to be able to do that. Again, there's a little piece of a job going through the office at the moment, which is the children's room of a club in Mumbai. But sometimes the notion of an idea that moves through a number of projects can happen. So that my very early 1963, God help us, 1963 tower on the left, the notion of the tower as a kind of coat hanger, as a kind of armature upon which you cast other things, moves through into the 2010s and later in a number of the notion of the tower as the kind of portmanteau or the hanger is something that interests me considerably. Another dream is a kind of does affect the kind of enclosure that one makes. The business of slithering. I once was having to make an exhibit next to this wonderful ramp in Sao Paulo. It's a very hard place to show a show because it is so beautiful, so total. And it slithered, that you just slither around. Oscar Niemeyer really knew how to do these things. And other friends of mine, such as Ron Arad, do the slither. You're getting the feel of the slither. And then in a project for Berlin again, one was fascinated by the notion of picking up on the aesthetic of certain round corners, but liked and preferred, and suggesting a slithering process. But I think it's also, in a way, affects how one operates, that one does actually slither. And one, I tend to use this kind of pen that allows you to just drift. I hate that kind of intersection. I like to slither. And in an unsuccessful competition project, we took up on the current success of British cyclists and put a series of cycle tracks as the kind of activating force within a campus. This notion that even in the coldest winter of Helsinki, you would see people gliding around. There'd always be the movement of the bike. And I was inspired by some weird trough that I saw once in Kuala Lumpur with a whole lot of guys on scooters pouring out of it. I've never been able to find it since. But I thought, what a great thing that you have these troughs with movement that are woven in between buildings. But slither certainly informs our largest building to date, which is the law faculty and the admin building, the two buildings in Vienna. And if you look at the way that we track the periphery, we are slithering around it. And then that slithering comes into the building because, in fact, the interstitial spaces between the more formalized room also start to slither and open out into a kind of series of stomach-like conditions. So the slithering isn't just only an encompassment, it is also a way of folding into space. Working into space. But it can also be the kind of slithering that one was looking at in some of the rhetorical drawings of the 80s, and then able to be applied back again many years later in Vienna. Or even the idea of interior slithering, of spaces that would not be hard definition. And in the Australian building, which you'll see more of later, there is also some trace of this same way of encompassing the contained space. A little more modestly, slithering, because this had to be a very cheap building, in fact, not quite as cheap as it turned out to be, social housing in Madrid. The story of this was that it was half built and then stayed with just a tower crane and a dog for about 2 years, waving in the wind. The guys had gone bankrupt. And then eventually when a builder was found, he built just the minimum enclosure. But it's still, to some extent, the organization still takes advantage of the diagonal views and diagonal conditions that you get from the slither. Or there's a detail slithering around the space that you can pick up in the Graz building and in the Australian building. The scoops, which are kind of way of slithering and holding space. So in recent drawings I say, yes, slithering is still a dream. Funny trick I've set myself over years is going as I travel a great deal and sometimes return to the same place quite often, made a kind of secret pact with myself that if I'd been there for something like a month, I would comment on the town by making a project for it. Nobody's ever sort of then said, why don't you do it? But nonetheless, I try. A long time ago, my first ever visit to Brisbane was for a month. I was teaching project, which was based upon the south side of the Brisbane River, which now has developed at that time, and I came up with two towers. One, a kind of what has now become almost a generic commercial sleek tower, a slithery tower. The other one based very much on the kinds of buildings you see in the bottom right-hand picture, which are the old metal, probably cast iron, bungalows or two-story buildings, which were lifted up on legs and allowed the breeze to blow through, natural cross-ventilation, and lifted on legs so the bugs didn't crawl up into the house.
And I thought, what would happen if you actually made a tower that was, in effect, a succession of these structures? And that was what was behind the first Brisbane project. And then it also involved catching the wind and making footbridges and a whole lot of sort of casting wind catch, try and get breeze down what is sometimes a rather hot town. My wife's city is Tel Aviv, and over the nearly 30 years that I've been coming and going to there, I have made certain observations about it. One is that it is full of very, very active people, very and entrepreneurial people. And so the tower on the left, which is intended, though there's no client, of course, intended for the center of that circle. Mr. Niemeyer visited Tel Aviv and did a couple of scribbles, apparently, and said that there should be, and then some local guys built the actual circle. But it was Niemeyer's intention that there should be three towers in the center, which haven't ever happened. Well, so I said, right, let's take the three towers, the apartment block, the car parking structure, and this, which is a kind of kebab of a number of different kinds of enterprises. And just like a kebab, you stick the stick up, and you don't expect the tomato to be the same as the sausage or the you know, whatever. And you don't expect the car showroom to be the same as the day hotel or the dentist's waiting room, etc. So it's a series of entrepreneurial types which are strung up the kebab. The other Tel Aviv tower is at the other end of town, Yafo, where I've often stayed. And here I'm looking at the notion of a building in a Mediterranean condition, which has a series of kites, which are effectively movable screen conditions within it. So you have basically a predominantly glass building, but then you have this series of layers of kite-like conditions within it. I broke my rule because I haven't actually totted up quite as much as a month in Rio or in Sao Paulo, but I was so fascinated. I mean, from being a second year student in Bournemouth, I was fascinated by Roberto Burle Marx, even before Niemeyer. And Carmen Miranda was a kind of phenomenon when I was a kid. And somehow this whole, and then actually being for a week and a half in the middle of the Ibirapuera Park, the Niemeyer and Park with early Marx doing the landscaping, is extraordinary. This extraordinary sort of joie de vivre of Brazil, even though it's dangerous and all the hell, but it's there's something that gets you. And as a North European, it's a challenge to try and say, what is it? Could one ever be as exotic as that? So if you look at the tower carefully, you can see that it's standard bit of post-plug-in as your father, but then it has kind of Brasiliana draped upon it. I don't claim it's my best tower, but it's one where I, you know, wear one's heart on one's sleeve, in a sense. And then an invitation from the intrepid Christian Feireis in Berlin, again to do a project, this time for Paris. Now, of course, the English, the London people have a big problem about Paris, because it's there, and we cherish the differences despite the similarities. And there I did a naughty, you know, it wasn't going to be built anyhow, but I said, okay, I will be modest in English, I won't take up much of your space, I'll just go to the edge of the Seine, near the Gardasters, and just put half the building in the water. Just, excuse me, just a little tiny. And then we'll put these apartments and we'll make them rotate so that if there's a row going on in the next apartment, you just sort of push a button and turn out of earshot. Or if the lupins are coming out in the Bois de Boulogne or wherever, you press the button and you turn towards that time of the year. You get a variety. And then a very dear friend of mine came in the next morning and showed me a picture of some German guy in 1928, who, of course, had done a house that had done exactly that. This sometimes happens, and it's often a friend who points out that your idea isn't original. What do you do? I think, oh, my life my life is but for nothing. Or you say, right, bloody good idea, wasn't it? And you have to take the latter. You have to take the latter position. But what do you also have in this particular conglomeration? Are little noddy houses. You actually have kind of North European allotments with little allotment huts, so that the bourgeoisie, or possibly, dare I say it, the male member of the bourgeoisie, can disappear out into the bushes and read the dirty newspaper or whatever people do in huts that are in allotments. Of course, it's well known amongst my friends that my favourite spot in the United States is Santa Monica. We're heading there on Friday. And we stay sometimes in a hotel that looks back on another hotel which looks like a kind of prison. I mean, it's expensive. I've never stayed there, but it looks like a prison. You think, we are in Santa Monica. It's the most wonderful moment. You know, it's the furthest west of our civilization kind of thing. And then you build a bloody hotel that looks like a prison. Wouldn't it be wonderful to pull a piece of the Hollywood Hills into Santa Monica? Well, that's my excuse. I just sat and did the drawing, actually. I said, pissed off with looking at the building. I said, let's do this. The most recent drawing I'm going to show you was finished 2 weeks ago. And it's a tower for an area that I walk past about twice, three times a week, because it's very near our studio. It's Highbury Corner, which is a fairly sort of nondescript piece of relatively inner London. It's a sort of local centre of some sort. And my tower is also looking at possible materiality. I think that in this particular case, it's very useful to have a marker for Highbury Corner. And I look across the street at the old Victorian chapel. I look at the bottom, and I look at the tradition of red terracotta and red brick. And in the middle, the glass building will perhaps morph progressively into something that is actually created by digital means and growths. It will be containing growies that will perhaps, rather, haven't done the six stages of this tower, which would take a lot of drawing, but would then show that actually the part that we see here, created in this manner, would gradually overtake and creep down, rather like an extraordinary kind of creeper that would then replace the skin. That's the idea behind it. In this section, the last illustration is of a project that isn't strictly speaking a tower and doesn't have a particular location. And that raises another issue, which is that sometimes in one's imagination, one is thinking about not the narrowness or the insistence of a particular site, but of the implications of certain things seen and enjoyed. I am fascinated by Edinburgh Castle, the top, because somehow the building appears to grow out of the rock. It's hard to tell in some parts of it which is the actual rock and which is the building. In the U-boat pens in Trondheim, you get the notion of this extraordinary kind of object by the water, this strange object. But my general fascination with waterside buildings is of course, in the period of the marvellous warehouses, of which I think the Hamburg warehouses are some of the best, where the water kind of almost infiltrates into the building. The building is a mechanical device for things being taken out of the water and planted into the building. So this funny object on the right, though it also has a lot to owe to the vegetational swathe of my work, is nonetheless very much influenced by these kinds of sideways thoughts. Now, what happens as it starts to evolve into real stuff? Early days with Christine Hawley, we did a small piece of Berlin. Easy to design, because on the west was a marvelous view of the Tiergarten and the square below, and at the back was a sheltered courtyard, and therefore the building, in a sense, designed itself. And I still love going back to Berlin. It's my third favorite city. And I'm afraid I still gravitate a bit to the west, but I'd need a whole afternoon to explain why that is. And of course, there's the famous Kunsthaus with Colin Pounier. One in competition. We had, I think, a marvelous jury. I would say that, wouldn't I? But I can't imagine other juries having bought the thing. It had to be done cheap. It is not high-tech. It really is not high-tech. It came in 2.5% only over the normal budget for a flat-roofed art gallery. It came in 2.5 months late, which for an arts building, I think, is almost coming in on the nail. Therefore, it could not have expensive detailing. It benefited from the kind of geopolitical situation, which was at that moment, there was still a leftover of the old sort of East European thing. Therefore, you could get blokes coming over the border on bicycles. You could get cheap pieces of steel in rail yards. There was also the advantage of a territory, the Mur Valley, which has had centuries of iron smelting and crafting and timber crafting, rather similar to the area around Stuttgart. And the building was a very simple proposition. When we looked at the 100 or however many entries for the competition, I think one criticism of other projects I could make was that they were too complicated. This is a funny old thing, but it's not actually that complicated. It's just a piece of enclosure of the available site. You just, again, glide around the site and say, that's the potato, that's the element. And you just have a pin that goes from the obvious corner, because we knew the town very well already. And it sits comfortably within its context. And of course, as night falls, it has these 920 points of illumination, which are, again, done on the cheap, just electric glass, electric lamp, standard bathroom fittings. And it sits like a friendly dog in the basket of the town. If you want to see the curved architecture, though, if you look carefully, a lot of those Baroque churches already had a curved architecture. Not quite so radical, really. Another competition win was for a municipal theatre in a small town called Verbania, north of Italy, on Lake Maggiore. But it was Italy, and we never got to build it. It was Italy, and somebody else copied it and got the money. I'm very bitter about this. But anyhow, to return to the project, it was a simple issue of really taking advantage of a small town. Yes, there is an auditorium for 500 people, and perhaps on high days and holidays, the burghers will go in there and sit there, watch a third-rate piece of acting and go to sleep, and then, you know, tete-a-tete with everybody in the foyer. So we made, but the real contribution the building can do is to create a place where things can happen both inside and outside. So the terraces, the places where you can watch open air movies, the places where this kind of thing, can readily happen, were the important part. And therefore, one might say rather pompously that its sort of urban contribution is the key to the project. The dream of melting, now that's a much more tricky one. Very, very difficult. Years and years ago, I was fascinated by almost implicitly destroying the tyranny of the window, of saying, does it have to be that the tradition of architecture says that you make a solid carcass and then you make holes in it, and then the discussion of the elegance or otherwise becomes a discussion of the proportion of the decoration or whatever of those holes, which it still seems to be. Isn't there some other thing that can happen? Can't we melt? Can't we glide into transparency, translucency, solidity? and various drawings did. We were allowed to do a little bit of it on grass until they discovered we were doing it and said, stop, it's getting too expensive. And there's, which is there, the melted, odd little moments in Graz where we could melt. And then there are other projects where the veg house that we've seen already becomes a veg village, but the village is a series of melting of one condition into the other. Or in another competition project, the notion of melting colour around a built condition. Or of a town melting into the fjord, in this case, melting into the water. Or here in a sort of joke drawing done for Populous, suggesting what would happen if various types of sport facility could be one typology melting into another typology, and particularly positing sort of the climber on top of the hotel, the football observed from helicopters and so on, very much in a kind of early Archigram tradition, though it's much, much later in time. And then about a year ago, asked by a Los Angeles magazine to do a little quick piece of architecture that fuses Los Angeles architecture with London architecture. Rather inelegantly, they called it the Califuck issue of the magazine. And my response was a couple of piers, one sticking out by Playa del Rey, incorporating consciously London overtones, and one sticking out near Gravesend in the Thames estuary, having Los Angeles overtones. Another dream that I think is very noticeable in 20th century, certain 20th century projects, is the dream of flying. As a student at the AA, I remember being allowed to see the original edition of Chernikov's 101 Fantasies. And that image has stayed. And when we got to the point, and my wife will remember this, we got to the point in the building of Graz where suddenly this thing happened. I was more excited by that than the bulbous part, which everybody always sort of made all the fuss about. But no, this candidly, this thing leaping into space, that was my magic moment. And I think that, since I mentioned Yale, she herself, a year or two back, did a project in Barcelona where it doesn't fly, but again, it points out that consistent tradition of architects to wish to inhabit the sky. Or is it that we can achieve this end by other mysterious means? And the wish is still to let it fly. Another dream, which I've already mentioned, is this question of overgrowth, of growies, of veggies, of vegetation as a constituent part of architecture, as a language of architecture, a language certainly of the covering. And if often I've been in Germany and I've been doing these drawings, and somebody comes up to you and says, "There's a place like you are making the drawing in our town," and you're dragged along to see some piece of Italian, like Schwetzingen, which is an amazing place where Italian gardeners of the 18th century were doing this. And my favourite example is in Karlsruhe, where in the middle of the 19th century there was this enclosure made. Now, boring people say, "Oh well, of course there was probably glass in it," but no, I found the actual drawings. There was not glass in it. It was intended as an armature which would take growing. So again, not an original, not a first off idea. It's been going for a while. Probably one has to admit to certain projects or drawings being one's own favourite. This is a particular favourite of mine, where I made an artificial landscape which had certain structurings within it. Now, it also includes bits of deliberately, provocatively naughty actual architecture. It has certain conditions which suggest organised drifting. It has other conditions where you see something sticking out that probably is architectural. And another one there. But then you get other conditions which are deliberately, and I was playing with myself, so to speak, that one is deliberately provoking the question, to what extent is the natural object, or could it be a tectonic condition, as in the urban mark last stage, to what extent does the architectural event have to be concealed or happening as an interloper, and to what extent is there a give and take between these conditions? I was fascinated by the notion of innuendo and complicity and drift and, in a way, generic type, which, of course, is simplified in other projects where one says, yes, this is very definitely a project that Gavin and I did together for one of the Biennales, and it deliberately places vegetated objects within a condition, or here where one uses the vegetation as both a garden encasement and a drift. And in a very cheap project that I've been working on lately, one suggests a series influenced in a way by the narrow frontage Japanese buildings, where one places vegetation as a kind of backdrop, number one, and as a system, number two, and then one goes to little local pieces of things that are in the tradition of the vegetated balcony or the winter garden. But perhaps the same kind of layered drift doesn't have to only have grown vegetated. The notion of laying drifted objects and layers and wafts is something that perhaps can be applied to other projects. One of our Taiwanese projects, where the pieces are actually wind farming, are to do with solar collection and to do with shading. But they are layered in series. And in a ridiculous piece of the London exhibition at the moment, one makes a kind of collage which is deliberately in that tradition. Another dream is the dream of the three-dimensional city. Hong Kong is a marvelous example. I love that condition in Hong Kong where you go up a series of escalators, and the escalators engage with crossed strata as you move up the hill. I'm fascinated, I've used this picture before, I know, but here's Sao Paulo again. And if you look from underneath Bobardi's wonderful art museum, you stand on that platform where the market is, and you look down and you suddenly realize there's a 6 or 8 stories below, there's another layer of activity. And then you look and there's another further on, there's another layer crossing it. You realize you are standing on top of a piece of three-dimensional city. It's tremendously inspiring, and I think that sometimes one's projects are taking off from, after all, I was a student of Peter Smithson and was very inspired by the deck conditions, which of course have been often misinterpreted, but I still think the notion of dancing over the ground, setting up a three-dimensional situation, is exciting, and that three-dimensional situation can take all sorts of physical forms. It can be laid as a kind of porous three-dimensional city on top of another city. And the porosity includes the solid, the slightly less solid, the very unsolid, and the totally percolated. Again, rather like the notion with the non-window, that there are many degrees of the presence of the object, or the presence of the surface. And one pursues Oslo in that manner. And even in a much smaller project for a part of Madrid, one is laying the main buildings on legs and letting the hill, the boardwalks and so on, drift under and amongst it. And that led in a way to the built building, which is intended to have the sports happening on the top, wonderful shutters and various kiosks operating underneath it. It's just they didn't have the money to go through all. I hope one day they will. More lately, a project for placing a piece of a university on as a series of buildings up on a four-cornered armature. So there's space between each department, and each space then can take on small-scale and temporary development. Each space has its own quadrangles. It's like you have a university building and a quadrangle, then up another one, another quadrangle, and up and another, leading to a kind of chunk city, should you wish. Or, of course, the three-dimensional implications of some of the tower projects, both, again, the 63 one, but also some much more recent tower project, where one is constantly implying the diagonalization of connection. Funny little old dream is really not a central one. It's a dream, what I call the dream of the hidey hole. We all want a hidey hole from time to time. And I'm fascinated when I go to Germany by two places particularly. One is the Kleinecker Gardens of Schinkel, these little tiny, funny, hidey places. And the other one is the Mathildenhöhe in Darmstadt, where Olbrich plants these funny little tempting little wee conditions. And in a very old drawing of mine, the prepared landscape, one has effectively a secret gully. You walk along over the hill, and then the thing is within. And if you go to Rauschen, my favorite English garden, there are these very spooky hidey holes which have toads and water, probably ghosts coming out of them. Nice, funny little old example I found about a year or so back, walking down an otherwise non-responsive street in Tel Aviv called Dizengoff. It's sort of big old commercial street, minding my own business, and suddenly there's a little sweet little lady popped out of a pink little hut. It's very un-Tel Aviv, and she sells antiques. Of course, I was using a proper camera. I didn't get round to the iPhone habit. And she saw me taking the camera. She darted straight, as do things what live in hidey holes do. They tend to dive back in. I wish I could have captured her. It's a wonderful, in amongst all this sort of dust and concrete and loudness and things, the little sweet hidey hole. But another kind of hidey hole are the curious reentrant spaces that you sometimes get as a product of the building. So if we look at the, you know, and not really, one would like to say they were highly intentional, they were there all along, but no, they became some of the best parts of the building are these, which are in themselves hidey holes. Or there can be little kiosks that hide in crevices. Or there can be pieces in our coloured Birmingham project which are piercing in. Or they can be the hidey holes within the Madrid housing. Or they can be the scoops that we find in our architecture school, hidey holes. Or in another project for Australia, they can be the hidey holes that are cut into the edges of the building itself. Or they can even sometimes be little hidey holes within kiosks. This is in Taiwan. One of our funny little hidey holes. I don't know what I've done. That seems to not be moving. But I did press something which might have been to do with it. Let's see if it goes. Stopped. Is there an expert? Oh, it hasn't stopped. And more hidey holes. In a project we're doing for a retreat in India. Stuff. Years and years ago, I started giving lectures about stuff, particularly in centres of excellence where people don't do very much stuff but talk a lot. And I'm not mentioning any names, of course. And it's interesting when you start getting from being a sort of drawer to a stuffist. And then you start noticing that you do tend to repeat yourself, or at least you have preference for certain kinds of stuff. Now these are all, now I'm able to say, built pieces of stuff of different scales, of different material, basically letting the light in, but doing, as it happens, doing it in very, very different ways. But the partie is the same partie. But then sometimes one does very exaggerated stuff. One of my towers is really an essay in all kinds of surface treatment, if you like. Or stuff as built. We've done furniture. We've been lucky enough to do all the furniture for the school, some of the furniture for the Austrian building, and we are now doing more. And it's a certain kind of stuff. It has its own preference. It even has its own little hidey holes within the stuff, of course. And then there's the stuff within the stuff, which becomes very, very interesting. In a moment, I'm going to be showing you the monocoque, the all-steel monocoque structure. But, of course, the part that now you don't see is all the flanging, which is actually the thing doing half the work. And here it is being made, transported from Germany, dropped into Bournemouth. But the flanges, the world of actually the force field of the stuff, is now hidden by the very elegant glass reinforced plaster. Oh, before I forget, the magic of the gadget. Being a child of the period of the Second World War. And of England, where we're all boffins and guys that go into huts and fiddle around with funny things. It goes back over years and years. It goes back to Victorian times. We love these gadgets. It goes to the period of the early robots. It goes through David Green and his Mobot. And a particular person I recommend to you, who is the English cartoonist of the early part of the 20th century called William Heath Robinson, whose constructions are bizarre and stupid and daft and sometimes horrific, but they link in a curious way to the British high-tech movement. I'm inviting some keen potential PhD to trace that, because it would be really fascinating, I think. But we live with gadgets all the time. We use gadgets without even a thought. And now the gadgets take on various forms that people in this, most people in this room don't quite know why they do what they do anymore. Some architects like to have gadgets so that their bedroom can go out into the rain. I was actually sitting on the bed at the time when it started raining, and by golly, we pushed the button pretty damn fast. And only yesterday we were in the Guggenheim looking at the wonderful piece of creative gadgetry, of course, and there are other people who are sending up gadgetry in their own ways. And way back, one of my first pieces of built work was a gadget which simply opens when it's hot and shuts when it's cold. Well, not high level, but gadgetry nonetheless. And gadgetry is with us more and more, even if sometimes we can't see it, even if sometimes it's deliberately silly and lovely, and it becomes an inspiration. These are algae-growing gadgets made into one of our Taiwan towers, and later gadgets in the later tower. And, of course, the kind of gadgetry that leads to something. When we were doing the scoops in Australia, we had to contrive, we wanted deliberately that they weren't all the same, that they were moulded slightly differently, but we had to keep within budget. And so we put our cleverest person in the office onto the maths. It took her about 2 months to get it sorted out, how you could use a very minimum number of pieces of shuttering and still get the computes that made each scoop different. We did also have to use some wonderful German patent removable shuttering. So it's the gadget as a lead-in to something. Oh, can't resist showing you things like this, because some of the nicest projects we've done have been really bone-ugly, and deliberately so. Or I go to Biennale, I don't look at all the serious stuff. I try and find the silliest exhibit there. And I sometimes do drawings that have absolutely no purpose, whether they lead anywhere. And yes, lovely, the silly situation. I love they both the British press and the German press, when Graz was built, said, "Ah, the blob, wonderful, the blob," you know. And then, God help us, there was a conference about that time done in Frankfurt called Blobmeister. I loved it because blob, I mean blobs, blob, and Meister, das ist der Meister. Natürlich. So there's this tremendous combination of the silly and the pompous. And in fact, of course, I have to explain that we have a great tradition of blobs in the UK. The best blobs, and we used to, I don't know what happened to him, but we used to have this cartoon character, kids character called Mr. Blobby. I have appropriated him. And we collect, Yael was in Beijing and saw a very good example of a cat. And I was in Valparaiso, Chile, and was photographing the kiosk, I collect kiosks, and I was photographing the bloke who had no English, and I certainly didn't have any, whatever they speak, Spanish. And he saw me getting the camera out. He, instead of doing what the lady did in the pink thing of diving away, he brought his dog up so that the dog would be photographed as the proprietor of the kiosk. It wasn't a very good photograph, but I sent it to my friend Tom Hennigan in Tokyo. He immediately sent this much better dog back, who is, of course, a Japanese dog, as proprietor of a kiosk. There's another series, which I haven't bothered you with this afternoon, which is called People Who Wear Animals on Their Head, which is another byway. I don't think I got it. But I have, of course, had periods myself of doing daft things. Daft applied sometimes happen. Gavin and I have a penchant for doing impossible competitions for which the prize money is less than what it costs to draw the thing. And in no way is going to be done. This was a footbridge competition in Skopje. God knows why we did it, but we decided. And I'm heavily into kiosks, which I explain here. And I said, let's put a kiosk on the bridge, you see. Seems perfectly reasonable, across the bridge, by newspaper, ice cream. And then Gavin said, hey, why don't we make the kiosk move? At which point I said, hey, why don't we put a bar on the top of the moving kiosk on the bridge, which has legs that come down at a certain time in the afternoon, so kids can buy a chalk ice underneath and somebody can go up and have a slip of it and look at the poxy river they've got down there. And of course, irony was, I was showing this about a year later in Japan, of all places. Suddenly a voice that was not Japanese at the back said, they built a concrete one. And he came from Skopje. We knew they were going to build it. I mean, this is the daftness. We knew all the time they were going to build a concrete one. There was no way they were going to put it. But I keep with it because somebody somewhere should build a bridge with a kiosk that moves and has a bar on it. And this is my policy for the last God knows how many years. It must be 8 or 10 years, whatever, 9 years old, this project. I still trot it out in every lecture that I can remotely make an excuse for it being in, because somebody out there, somebody's got a parent in Beijing or wherever the hell it might be that wants a kiosk that moves. I guarantee, I believe it. I'm getting near the end, not quite near to the end. And one other thing, my wife says that as I get older, I get more interested. You can't teach for nearly 50 years without noticing people, I think. And even in early projects of the, what was this, 70s, early 80s, whatever, one was interested in associating certain type of person with a certain kind of environment and a certain piece of the town. And another type of people in a different kind of environment, in a different piece of the town, and so on. When we did the competition for the Vienna building, law faculty, I did a couple of cartoons, one of which, this one on the left, suggests that a university doesn't have to be a deadly place, that you could have, by reading a Viennese life, particularly that aspect of Viennese life, which I know well, that could go on in a university, you see. And when we won the competition and built it, we kept the notion of these as I described earlier, these opening out flowing spaces. We kept them in the project. Unfortunately, I can't get a slide with anybody doing anything in it. You can kind of make the space, but they don't seem to be doing anything very... nothing going on there at all. It's all going on outside. Sometimes you have a situation... This was the competition to do a cultural area, cultural zone in Gold Coast. Now, anybody who knows Gold Coast knows that it's actually... its cultural scene is this. They're not big on opera and stuff like that. They're not big on reading books. In fact, there's no bookshop in a city of 500,000. There's only a bookshop that sells sort of cookery books. Very weird. Anyhow, but we tried to make it chirpy nonetheless. But we're getting into safer territory or perhaps more contentious territory was the... being invited to take part in a competition for an architecture school. Ha-ha! Because you have to remember that when one did Graz, I had actually been the director of the Institute of Contemporary Arts. I had run a thing called ArtNet. I knew about hanging exhibitions and dealing with customs officers and crates and programs that come late and people who have a fit hanging something on a wall. And I did know a little bit about architecture schools by the time we came to do this. And Gavin, who'd been to several, including GSD and other places, and the Bartlett. So we were mostly, when we were discussing the project, we were really using anecdote. We'd say, you know that funny corridor they've got at UCLA which goes above the crit room, but you don't have to go in? That's not a bad idea. You know that funny corner they've got down in the basement? You know the room at the A that's the thing, the one behind? And it was all to do with, you know that funny, you know Cooper's big room? That's not bad. I mean, so that's not a bad idea. That's not a bad idea. And it really, it, well, you'll see it had quite a sensible plan, but it sort of grew from anecdotal information. But the, and it grew so that it could, in fact, for large parts of it, the students create the conglomeration themselves. And a lot of it is based on anecdotes such as this. As an old teacher, I observe how the pompous young faculty can put the student in a nervous state. And there's Barbara, her hand shaking, her notes. And Joe, her friend, is already nervous. And Fred has a, this is a typical Bartlett situation, has a wonderful electronic thing that was working last Thursday. Will almost certainly not work on this occasion. And then when you've just come off the jury and you're going down to have a quick drink, the faculty member come running up, it's got it working, it's got it working. And you go back and then it stopped working. You know the story. And this is a typical situation. And it is in fact based exactly on the truth. There is Barbara in SIARC with her papers in her hand, nervously commenting or trying to deal with a smart-ass young faculty comment. The young faculty, as is very common in the US of A, I've noticed, is more interested in making an impression upon other members of the faculty, not particularly interested in the project. But they can be good. I suspected I might hit a nerve. Here's another. You have to bear in mind that Gold Coast is 500,000 people with even suburbs called surfer's paradise. This is the best beaches in Australia. And it is unlikely that all the members of the school community are actually in the building. And here's a typical situation. Nice to see you in the building, Jules. And the important thing here, architecturally, is to deal with alternative means of escape. And having, if you're, more particularly if you're the director of the school, you are the one that most needs the means of escape. You see somebody incredibly boring heading in your direction. God help you, you need a second. Notice you don't have a very good means of escape. You're too democratic here. It's very important, both for cat and for mouse. Here's another one which I was able to, it's quite nice because sometimes, I did 25 of these cartoons, not all of which I'm showing, and it was interesting, after we built the building, I could find actual situations. Here's a typical situation, this poor guy, he doesn't stand a chance with the girl in the corner, but you know, it's an excuse for opening up studios to each other. And indeed, I found a dark-haired girl. Sorry, I keep pressing on that. A dark-haired girl. There she is. In pretty much the location that I'd imagined you to be in. It's Australia, and so there's always a bottle of wine and situations which we know well. But this is really an encouragement to the faculty to make sure it was a 24/7 condition. A little bit of flattery to the jury to suggest that there might be people passing through from Princeton. And of course, as we know from visiting critics, they're always back somewhere tomorrow night's plane. But it was flattering. And the key thing about the building is that it captures light. And in Queensland, you get some wonderful light. You have to capture it, but you also have to protect the interior from the light. And another thing which is happening is that the building is being used by the whole university as a kind of quote-unquote venue. As we predicted, you can certainly see the guy with the teeth fully enjoying the facility. Or here's a wonderful one because my cartoon was really, again, sending up faculty saying, this poor guy, here's the poor guy who's mortgaged his house, 50-something maybe, mortgaged maybe 60-something, mortgaged his house to do a master's degree, listening to, oh, guys have to accept the point of departure. And then I'm caught with exactly the same gestural movement. Life imitates art, I think. And we capture the light, and then there's the prow of the building coming forward. Always, of course, it's Australia, and they're very health and safety conscious, so for the amateur such as myself, impossible to photograph anything without a hydrant booster or two. It's a wonderful place. Lots of other conditions. I'll just mention the one on the left. It's important as a teacher to pretend that you find everything interesting. Here are two young faculty members trying to have a sort of afternoon in the sun. And this guy comes, oh, I thought you might find this interesting. It is not remotely interesting, but the trick is to pretend that you do find it interesting. Otherwise, the guy might be done for the next 10 years. And this is happening on the terrace condition. The building designs itself in the sense that we have an east-west... Oops! I keep getting these buttons. Where do I go? Yeah. The path runs east-west. The scoops articulate the path, the different scoops, and form the primary structure. To the north, which remember is the hot side in Australia, we put the smaller rooms and the toilets and the stairs and the faculty rooms and the research rooms. And the studios go gently down the hill. And then this is the terrace condition that we saw the guy with the piece of wood standing outside. So it's a very simple, actually very simple direct plan when all said and done. here are the scoops in action, and a cast back to the similar conditions that we managed to incorporate into the Vienna building on the right. As I say, the students in fact create their own spaces really within. And the captain of the ship sits on the poop that moves out into the front, of course. But one of the underlying interests in our, I think both Gavin and I, we don't like sort of there you are, there it is, full frontal architecture. We enjoy things that are hinted at, that are glimpsed. I think it comes back to that landscape drawing in a way. The innuendo, the notion that there might be a further space beyond that. This is, I think, a very Gothic condition. And you have wonderful light there that you can make it with. And then in the west is finally lighting down the street. And the old cartoon from the competition stage is also really a statement too, which is that much of the business of designing after the initial thoughts, and we usually have the basic ideas very quickly within the first day or so, but the tweaking and the tweaking and the tweaking and the tweaking and the tweaking, that's what makes it really come alive. I moved back to Bournemouth and the Blue Building, my first piece of architecture in England, really very much in, it's an absolutely straightforward building. It is a studio. Therefore, you study the North Light. You look at the studio tradition, both particularly Belgium and some parts of London. And the main orifice is in fact in that tradition. It's just simply a studio, north-facing studio light that is tilted so that you are not distracted by anything happening at ground level. You only see some of the indigenous pine trees, which are very much important to Bournemouth. And it sits in a small cleft within a very tight-packed little campus. And in the computer rendition, we're already anticipating the kinds of light conditions that will happen. And in an early drawing, I don't do, in this case, cartoons per se, but the cartoons are there, and I report on that later, of the types of people who are typically to be found in that university. Many of them local, many of them getting into doing art pieces late in life, specialise in that. Some who are not particularly interested, but just it's a nice place to be. Others who are trying desperately to intellectualise. Others who, hey, art's cool, it's great, yeah, well. And people who've been itching to be there all their lives. And this is the reality of the situation. Poignantly opened by Zaha. She was the opener in the building and died a week later. It's the last time I saw her. Ha! Just before I leave, by the way, in case you hadn't noticed, I quite like colour. And it comes from the period of Archigram through to later times. Sometimes very silly, but in sort of project, they're not projects really, they're drawings where you try out a whole lot of funny bits and pieces of ideas that might crop up in something built later. So the dreams go in and out of reality. And colour can happen. And can be very, very ridiculous sometimes. So, at the moment, we have been asked to do another building on the same campus. I can't show you much of it, but it's a sort of hint that something's going on there. And it's to be deliberately so small you can't really see what it is. It's actually the fabrication laboratory, the fab lab, which we're making, have certain robotic overtones. to be, you'll know in a few months when it starts being published. Looking at Bournemouth again sometimes and the pine trees, doing a fairly large project in the middle of a giant tower, two floors of a giant tower in Mumbai, which seems to now be happening, but it's been taking ages to get going. It's Indian. Lots of exhibitions at the moment. And a weird one. I don't know whether there's a psychiatrist in the house, but why do I like noses? I don't know. You will forgive me, finally, for a quick piece of advertising. Thank you.
I'm starting to be speechless, right? Some of us have themes, others have concepts, but Peter has dreams. And dreams are completely open-ended. And this is what has fascinated me, what you did tonight. The open-endedness of every one of the theme you brought, including the one of the hidey holes, right? Find that as an architectural concept, right? But also, how at the, you know, towards the end, you become serious and you say, look at the light. And it shows, you show a cartoon, then you show a drawing, a plan, you know, real plan, which is, the cartoon is somehow irreverent, but the plan is extremely elegant, and then the built part is extraordinary because of what you then say, you know, you have to massage it, you have to bring it into the light. And I discover a completely different side of you, right? Peter, the very sophisticated architectural builder. And I'm very excited about that, right? So, in reality, we could have several conversations. And I thought this morning that the conversation that we might have is, what would it be to be Peter Cook today? And let me try to bring five themes, and then each of these five themes will become a question to Peter, and Peter will respond whichever way he wants. So let me start with the first theme. You, in the mid-60s, in the middle of a rather, we're pre-68, in a rather conservative corporate architecture scene, you and some of your friends, Cedric, Yonah Friedman, and a few others, invent a new and different form of practice. You don't fit into a mold, you don't fit into a precedent. And that type of practice is interesting because at the same time, it's like a social commentary. Second point. Architecture is generally fairly straightforward. You have square meters, you have office space, you have living rooms, you have theaters and cinemas and town halls. And you guys start to think of walking cities, plug-in cities, instant cities. The word city, by the way, is interesting. But rock plugs, you invent programs. And I was happy to see that you haven't stopped, right? Your Skopje footbridge, the kiosk that moves with a bar on it, is very much a continuation of this thing of saying, no, the architect is not simply a service provider, as the AIA tells us, but it's also someone who invents what we may need. Remember Cedric and his various artifacts. I'm thinking of the pottery think belt. It's an invention. Third point, drawing. You cannot think without drawing in such a way that it allows you to think in the direction you want to think. All your melting, all your slithering and your metamorphosing requires a certain way of drawing. Or maybe it's the other way around. It's the way you draw that allows you to invent each of these quite extraordinary mode of not only of representation, but of what the ideas are about. And here I see something unbelievably important is the relationship between the thought and the way you draw. I'll come back to that. Fourth point, one needs somehow to have a, how can I say, an outlet. You have to do propaganda in a way for your ideas. So you invent a vehicle called Archigram, which is a media magazine. In other words, it's inventing also the mode of distribution of the ideas. Very important today, nowadays, of fake news. And my final point will be about education, or my final question. In many ways, you have been what we would call, you know, the Meister, since you use that word, of education, because you have, in a way, taught many, many of us. So, if you allow me now to go back to these very five very serious points. The first one, and I'm thinking very much of this audience, which is also very aware of the fact that it's not the profession. As a friend of mine, filmmaker, called the professionals of the profession, are not quite the one that invent what it is. And so, how did you guys, and you in particular, because you were also a bit of a catalyst, decided that there was a niche or a major piece of action that was possible without using any of the recipes or of the formulas that were common in the day, or today the same thing happens?
I think there's one simple thing was that I and Ron in particular had read a lot about the period of Brunetaut and the magazine Frühlich and the glass chair, the letters of the glass, and thinking, and I suppose it's also something to do with a taste for the expressionist stream of European architecture rather than the rational stream. And those guys were similarly crazy. They were in a difficult point in history, I think 1920. And they weren't being given any work. They just had ideas, and they exchanged ideas. There was a certain camaraderie. I think that as soon as we... I think one of the strengths, maybe it's not answering your question there, is that the group Archigram differed over 10 years in age. No two from the same architecture school. No two with the same taste in this, that, or the next thing. But I think there was that. So there was that as a memory. There was a sort of now defunct tradition of the avant-garde that if you could make a pronouncement, you had to publish it yourself, you had to draw it yourself and staple it together yourself and put it on somebody's bicycle yourself. There was the fact there's always a way of communicating. I was, of course, one of those spotty children who used to make sort of magazines when I was a school kid. I used to invent magazines. I believe Peter Eisenman did the same thing about football.
Yeah, but
though I mean, okay, let's not go down that route.
No,
But no. I think the business is that there will always be a medium. You know, we wanted to have color in Archigram 1, so we made a potato print, which is the cheapest way of getting a red dot on. There's always a way. There's always a way. You know, I mean, I think that had we... Now the Japanese make Archigram knickers and T-shirts. Had we known how to print onto knickers, we would have done it. There was nothing... You know, what I'm saying is that there's always some sort of way. You can do it by baking a cake or writing a placard or making a movie or wearing funny shoes, or I think it's just that most of us are, I think the architectural profession is trained, you only do things in a certain sort of way. You know, you only speak when you're spoken to, kind of attitude.
Yeah, but my point is that you invent the goals that you're trying to achieve. You're not trying to fulfill some requirement that has been determined by, quote, unquote, society or the profession. Mm-hmm. You invent it as you go along.
Yeah.
And that's what I thought was fascinating in your talk, is that you even go to the point that you do a drawing and you don't quite know where you're going you're going within it.
And they're the most interesting ones. The ones that end up looking like you thought they would, you're probably bored by them halfway through. Because you're actually drawing in order to find out. You're not necessarily drawing in order to demonstrate. I think that's an essential difference.
So can I ask, do you choose the title of the drawing before or after, or it all depends?
Very often before, because that tells you a direction, but doesn't tell you how. It tells you what you're trying to do.
And then do you change the title when the building has...
It has been known.
It has been known.
It has been known also for one to do a drawing and then think of a very smart title about 20 years later. There is actually a caption on something. I changed the title of something yesterday morning in considerably tweaking the lecture. I thought, why haven't I ever called it that? And that was the Tel Aviv Tower with the kites on it.
Yeah.
I wanted something to explain, and I've never called it that. Now it will take that title, but only since yesterday. Because suddenly that picture of the kites explains what those things were inside that I'd been itching to try and describe. You see?
Yeah. Do you know what I find interesting? Is that everyone, then I'm going to get to the third question, but we already addressed it on the first and the second one, which is drawing. You draw by hand. What a strange thing to do, right? You know, I could have people raise their hand. How many of you draw with their hand, right? Not too bad. Could be better. Tell me, as this is an option, how do you do the cover?
Oh, I still use the airbrush sometimes.
Yes.
I use pen. I come over. They've stopped selling Prismacolor in the United Kingdom. I have to raid college shops or whatever. I have to buy them when I'm here each time. I use watercolor more and more. Watercolor I find increasingly controllable. I'm much better at watercoloring now than I was when I was a student, or even 25 years ago. I'm much more confident, but it's quite quick. And then occasionally I get somebody to color it for me, but very, very rarely. And occasionally something gets put onto a computer and is colored, but that's very, very, very rare.
Okay.
Is that the sort of answer you wanted?
Oh, that's exactly the... This is...
I mean, it seems to me very, very obvious. You use a crayon, sometimes you use watercolour, sometimes you use an airbrush, and sometimes you use a different crayon. I can discuss paper types with you. It does actually make a big difference.
Yeah, that's not tonight, but it'll come.
Well, there's an aspect which I can't resist commenting on, which is the business of the heave-ho. I remember Gavin, when he finally admitted that he could use the computer, which is when we were working on a competition, Christine and I and CJ, and I said, I wish somebody could just knock that up in a wireframe just so we could see what it's doing. He said, I'll go upstairs and do it. And I never knew he could use a computer. And there are times when but on the other hand, I think I was not a great drawer at school. I drew with difficulty. I found tricks, gradually get, and there are things I can't draw. Can't draw trees and dogs and all that stuff. But there is a business of having to fight the drawing that makes you really have to think about what you're drawing, particularly turning corners, things like turning corners, bits where there's a lot of twisting going on or something. You have to think, how the hell can I do that? And you kind of sweat over it. And in the process of the sweating, you've really given it a lot of thought. Whereas if you could just press a button, it goes, there it is.
Okay. Now let me tell you why I asked you about color. What fascinated me today, because I saw many more photographs of your actual buildings than I had seen before, that they are buildings which you would not do in that way if you were using the computer. I think that, you know, when you add a certain number of rods in front of the windows in different directions, you use a device and a technique which is the one that comes from your drawings. When you use colors in the buildings, you also do it in a way that you wouldn't do it if you were using, you know, whatever software. And that's what interests me. In other words, the extent to which the mode of representation that you use has actually a major effect on the building you design. Yeah. And I'd like you to talk more about that.
Yeah, I mean, and you will remember this too, there was a period at the AA when the sort of the Dalibor Vasily people would draw everything very soft, and it's always such a line, but they couldn't actually quite touch the edge of things. I, on the other hand, have always been fascinated by the actual edge. And therefore, I still quite like the fact that if I do an ink drawing, I fill the color to the edge of the ink, rather than making the edge of the color. Though strictly speaking, if you have a stucco building or brick building or plastic or whatever, you don't have a line at the edge. But I'm interested in the containment.
I'd say the building has a line at the edge, yes. It doesn't fade away so easy.
But it doesn't have a articulation of that. It just does stop. And I think I have tried doing sort of soft-edged drawings, but they always irritate me afterwards. And another funny thing about drawing, it's not quite about the color, but I was a very grubby pencil drawer as a student in Bournemouth, where everything was done in pencil. I had to buy harder and harder and harder pencils. I was buying 9Hs. Oh, not because I liked them, but because I got so grubby with anything softer. When I got to the A, it was ink, and that was great, because then I could stop worrying. So maybe my satisfaction with the ink drawing, that suddenly I discovered something where I could get what I wanted. That then becomes a post-rationalization. There's a very funny thing about color and the Pompidou Center. The plug-in city drawings originally were colored in those green and yellow and red and so on for a kind of color coding. The shops are in yellow, the tubes are in green, but this is in blue and that is in red. But it became an aesthetic subconsciously. It became preferred palette, though it had started off as a coding palette. That's a funny one. And there are other things about color that are very personal, like I love using orange now, but I couldn't use orange for about 35 years because the generation ahead of me, my teachers, my provincial teachers, all used a certain kind of gray, military gray and orange. It was very fashionable in the 50s or something. And therefore, me as the next generation would rather be seen dead than using their colors. There are all sorts of funny layers about color. And you get bored with certain colors. And you appropriate colors that other people have traded. I mean, it's a subject, but because it's been so, what really saddens me is that so many really good architects are scared of colour. Enrique Miralles, who I think is one of the most genius people I've ever known, but he didn't have a colour sense at all. Actually, crappy colour sense. But absolutely fantastic architect. And it makes me sad. I wonder why I didn't like it. Because I think it's not considered proper to like how you're kind of immediately thought as sort of flim-flam.
You know, Hollywood, I'll continue with the mode of representation and the way one thinks. You probably remember very well when in London, two groups of people, you were not part of either of them, made a distinction between a group that called themselves the 9H and the other one called themselves the 6B. I don't know if you all know the difference in terms of the type of lead that a pencil can do. And they were ideologically extremely opposed to one another and would not talk to one another. You remember
that? I can't remember the 6B people at all. No. Who were they?
I had to invent it to make my argument.
Ah, okay.
So, although I know who they were, you know, Dalibor would have been a 6B, right? We have, there are a few sort of heroes. This person we mentioned, Dalibor Wesley, was called a Czech surrealist, right? And had arrived in London at a time when major political changes were happening in his place where he lived. The next point I was going to ask you about, but I think we've somehow touched upon, was indeed the media, and the media, you invented it. One of the things that I remember of you is, you know, the big thing about media is distribution. How do you actually get to disseminate all those fantastic things you've printed? And how do we do that today? We have, you know, you can have a blog, you can have Facebook. But I remember you walking with dozens and dozens of magazines under your arm and distributing them to bookstores or to friends or to schools, and bringing a sort of it was like belonging to a secret society, those who had, you know, the last issue of Archigram. And that was incredibly desirable. And I heard about you, you know, in a Berlin bookstore, right? Never. And it looked different from your average architectural magazine, which, by the way, after so many years, haven't changed. They do the same thing over and over again. Okay, so any comments on that?
Yes, I have a comment from this morning. Observing my lovely wife on doing Facebook so well, she's a great natural Facebooker, and I watched her so long, I thought, fuck it, I only joined in 2 weeks ago. And this morning, I wanted to put some stuff on, and I realize that I'm instinctively wanting to use it like a magazine. So I tried to put in a kind of large red letters and various things, and it wouldn't, I don't know, maybe I'm not good enough, it wouldn't do it. And it only has this boring sort of standard lettering. You're meant to make a comment, and then you go and make a comment. But, you know, remembering that really interesting things you look at have picture, but picture merged into the words, big words, red words, oblique words, balloon words. Like, I wanted to use it. I guess there are tricks of doing it, basically making an artwork and then calling it a photograph. But in other words, it forces you down a rather commonplace means of communication. You have the photo, the friendly comment, or the bit of text, which is pretty limited. So although the medium is amazing, it's out there, it gets instantly. The actual quality of the thing, what you are looking at, tends to be homogeneity. It tends to be banal. Everybody does photos of their friends. Everybody does a sort of four-liner, six-liner, whatever. It's a bit boring. If it was a, you know, if it was a magazine, it would go out of business. But it's that's not the point. I know it's not the point. But there I was. My answer is based on this morning. I'm sitting after I'd done the last. I'd got done enough tweaking of this lecture, so I thought, right, let's go back on the Facebook. And it's very boring. I mean, I'll go on with it, but it's not a joy to look at. And I think that's terribly sad. Does that sort of answer? Well, it does sort of answer your question. We'll have to do it.
I can only come, you know, agree. Last point. You have been involved with architectural education for forever. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's a statement that says that if you want to learn about something, you teach. Mm-hmm. If you were to try to say, what have you learned over these years architecturally, in terms of what you got through teaching, what would it be?
I think I've learned more about people than about architecture. I have a horrible suspicion, this is going to be a very naughty thing to say, that I probably could, if I'd been privileged enough to spend the same amount of time, how I would have earned money, I don't know, just looking at buildings, I would know more about architecture. But I was looking about people, because a lot of the processes that you go through with students is not about where you put the staircase or which book you should read or, you know, what philosophy you should follow. It's actually about how you can get that poor bugger to stop being neurotic or, you know, and or whatever it might be, you know, stop drawing with their foot or whatever. I think I've learned a lot about people, but they happen to be mostly student people, faculty people. And then, do you learn about it? Yeah, there are one or two, relatively small handful, who have been fascinating people who I've watched become very interesting architects. But they are a tiny number. To be a bit down on that one. I mean, I should be saying, you're all marvelous, and of course you all have great architecture in your soul and body, but it's not true.
What I've watched you be able to do is to get an incredible amount of work from your students.
Yeah, but you have to know the student. You have to know the student. The trick is to get to know the student. I loved one of the processes I loved doing, particularly at the Bartlett, was interviewing, looking at portfolios. And the trick was not to, it's like when you go in an apartment of somebody and you know they're an architect. So you know there's going to be a copy of SMXL on the shelf. In fact, it'd be odd if there wasn't a refrigerator. So you don't even look at it, you know it. But then there's suddenly a funny book about toads or something in the corner. And I've been fascinated in portfolios. They've done it. The Germans, all the buildings look the same. I don't know if they're English, there are lots of scruffy things at the back. But you always look at somewhere there will be something that's a bit odd, even if it's the way they tie the portfolio together, or they've used some funny clip, or there are photographs of mushrooms or something. And you get in on it and say, ha, you're into mushrooms. And then, where did you grow up? And they say, I grew up in Zagreb or something. And then you say, and then you start talking to them about mushrooms in Zagreb, or it might be. And then you're getting a little bit of a story. Okay, this is this sort of person. And I love that. Because then you can work with it. And I think when I was doing the GSD a couple of years ago, my students told me I was the first person that had actually talked to them about them. Maybe it's that kind of a place where nobody talks about them. But I was really interested, not only because it was more boring than not knowing about them, but then 4 weeks down the line, you know, somebody's having boyfriend trouble, somebody's, you know, trying to get an Australian passport, somebody else has, likes a particular kind of coffee. And then you find that it, you can sort of talk about how I turn a corner or what sort of on the back of it. I really think it's integral with that. It's to do with the people.
I could go on forever, but just listening to you, I may also try remind the audience that Peter is a fantastic writer, and that's another part of your activity, but we won't touch upon that.
But you just write about what, you know, yeah. The thing is to write as if you were talking.
Which you do very well.
Yeah, indeed. I can't research, can't keep notes on things. Like, that's why I always get, I have a lovely time with my publisher changing the date of things. She says, but you said it was 1992 in that. I said, well, it was around 1992. So she said, why does it say 1993 on the drawing? I said, well, yeah, okay, that'll do. Like the thing this morning, the kite tower. Now it's the kite tower. I shall pretend that it was always the kite tower, if you wish. I don't care a bugger, really.
Before I conclude with a serious conclusion, I'm sure there are plenty of questions in the audience for Peter.
Hi, thank you. One of the first drawings you talked about, it wasn't about the technology on Archigram drawings, but it was about romanticism. And for nowadays generation, we are starting, what do you think it should be? What should we look at and think about more in a romantic way? What should we look at nowadays?
I think, I mean, where I use romantic is very close to the sort of dreaming thing. You say, okay, the obvious thing to do with this is that. But what else could it be? And what else could that be if it was that? It's like playing. It's like speculating, it's like dreaming. But when I applied it to the Plug-in City drawing, the point I was making was that in our day job at Taylor Woodrow, we were actually working on precast concrete for housing. They didn't do any, but we were working on it. And one had been brought up as a child of you know, the ethos of prefabrication, which is still extremely valid now. But it always ended up looking boring. You thought, well, you know, repeat units don't have to be. They can be folded and massaged and turned on themselves and picked in and picked out. They still would have the logic of the components. And it started as that. So it became, Plug-in City had kind of molehills and crevices. And if you look at the drawing, it's deliberately not doing, there it goes, but it's deliberately molding the thing because the components could do that, actually.
It might seem like a random question, but do you prefer drawing in the mornings or in the evenings? Oh.
I'm a morning person. I'm married to a lady who's a nighttime person, and if I'm writing or drawing, my ideal time now, I'm probably getting a bit slower. I probably don't get up till about 8, but my ideal time for writing or drawing would have been about 6:37 in the morning. And on competitions in the past, I now have people sort of working all night and I merrily trot off home. But I would be the person who would go home at about 11 at night because I'm useless. I'm totally out. Even as a student, I did one all-nighter in fifth year and I was out for about a week. It was totally counterproductive. So I'm somebody who starts competitions very early. I spend weeks and I hate the last minute rush, but I'm best in the mornings. I can write 1,000-1,200 words before 10 o'clock in the morning. Then it's downhill. And I'm still, this is a digression, but I'm still, I'm the generation that enjoyed having a proper lunch. And nobody seems to have a proper lunch anymore. It's terribly tragic. A proper lunch would mean that you were not in a condition to do anything very much till about 4 o'clock again. But then you might have another burst, you see. So if you've done it quite a lot by about 11:30 in the morning, or 12, and then you have proper lunch, then you don't do anything till about 4, and you have about a 2 hour, and then you watch TV or whatever the hell you do, and then you might do one more hour and still go to bed fairly early with a good scotch, and then that. I think that's quite a long working day, actually, because it's really intense when you're doing it. There's none of this sort of, which I notice in a lot of commercial offices, everybody's in front of the screen. And they might be sort of, God knows what they're watching, and they have their lunch in the office. They have this terrible sandwich, and the screen is still on, and they look as if they're working. In fact, they're watching rubbish, or they're mindless, or watching football. But the point is to be seen to be at work. This is something that's grown up, I think, in the last 20, 30 years. It's a terrible, terrible thing to be seen to be at work. Whereas I think 4 really good hours, proper lunch, pissed or otherwise, probably not pissed, and then, you know, a proper another 3 hour go at it. Wow, that's value for money, and it's intense, and you've got the energy to do it, and your brain. And lunch can be a marvelous, proper lunch can be a marvelous time when you discuss ideas, when you're with a couple of cronies, and you're having this idea and that idea, and stupid ideas and stuff, and then it mulls, and then, wow, back again.
You, I'm talking to the audience, you wouldn't have thought that coming to Colombia would be a way to learn about what I told you at the beginning. You are a social commentator of sorts, even in your work, and especially in the work. And I think I was really fascinated by the consistency over the years. In other words, the theme that you bring, the dreams, are recurrent. And they evolve, and they evolve now from something that came probably from, indeed, the early avant-garde to build dreams, which I think are extraordinarily beautiful, and congratulations, Peter.
Thank you for that.